Hi, my name is Norman. Flying Bear Ghost 6. Fear of the Sun. So today we got something very, very exciting. And yes, I'm well aware it's time to get a wireless microphone because this one is... Yeah, anyway, so today we got something very, very exciting. This one was sent to me by Flying Bear, free of charge. Of course, this is not gonna change my opinion on the product. If it's crap, I'm gonna tell you it's crap. But honestly, I have high expectation. It looked very, very promising on the website. So, let's see if they deliver what they promise. The printer comes in a fairly, well, standard 3D printer packaging. So everything is securely packaged in foam and plastic wrap to protect the goodies against shock and moisture. Spoiler alert, it worked, so no damage during transport, which is great. Workout complete, I guess. Because the printer is basically 95% pre-assembled, they put foam on the insides to protect the print bed and the gantry. And I also like how they use the space below the print bed to put, you know, important stuff. The printer comes with basic tools for 3D printing. And this here is the filament sensor. Then there's the cutest filament spool I've ever seen. PLA, by the way. These are parts for the door. And then there's the manual, a spare hot end, Bowden tube, USB cable and power cable. And here in the front is the extruder and a spool holder. The manual is completely in English, which is nice. You can also see that it's printed in colors, which is also not very common. And also, honestly, the paper is very nice. So hats off, pretty nice manual here. We're gonna use that and enjoy using it, which is rarely seen nowadays. I'm not gonna go too in-depth about the assembly because, well, that's pretty straightforward. I basically just followed the manual step by step, you know? So we're gonna start with the door. Brace yourselves. That was a lot less satisfying than I anticipated. The hinges were already attached to the printer, so it's just four screws at the hinges and one screw at the magnetic doorknob. The extruder, basically same thing, two screws at the sides and zip tying the cable to a strain relief. Next on the manual are the filament sensor and the spool holder. Subscribe. And again, it's just as simple as it gets. And the last step of the assembly is changing the power supply to accept European input voltage. Because I'm in Europe, in case you didn't know. Let's see if I can get it better this time. Yeah, that's more like it. The provided power cord is unfortunately very short, so I had to swap it with one I had lying around at home. Here we go, moment of truth. It's alive, yay. Overall, I gotta say it was a very pleasant building experience. The manual was easy to understand and helped a lot with the assembly. Up to this point, I actually only used tools provided out of the box by Flying Bear. So that's also a great thing if you don't, if you're not a certified tool hoarder as I am. Pretty cool to have all the tools you need to assemble this printer. So once we get this protective piece of paper off the printer, there are two things to remember. Number one, never touch the print bed with fingers. And number two, keep that piece of paper because we're gonna need that later for calibration. So yeah, I got all excited and I zapped a little bit through the menu and I homed the Z-axis for no apparent reason. And I messed a little bit with the calibration assistant, which we're gonna use later. But enough shenanigans, so let's load up the filament. I preheated the nozzle already. So the next thing to do is pushing the filament through the filament runout sensor. And here we got our first hiccup. If your filament isn't perfectly straight, you can see here I'm bending it on purpose. It's gonna be hard to push it through the sensor because there's a lot of wiggle room. So yeah, you need to straighten the filament to be able to push it through the sensor. But once you're in, you can push it through the PTFE tube into the extruder. Almost, because at the other end of the tube, we got the same problem. I mean, both parts being made out of clear plastics is definitely helpful to know, you know, what's going on. However, I'd like to see some conical shapes at these sections so that the filament is gonna find its way a little bit easier. But of course, we're gonna manage somehow, and now we can let the extruder do all the work. The extrusion is initially black. That's because I assume there's some sort of quality control, so they tested it before shipping, which is a good thing. And now you can see it's slowly turning to white. So, before we begin with the bed leveling, there's one last thing. It's checking the belt tension. And, well, here it was spot on right out of the box. So the basic idea of print bed leveling is getting the bed at a perfect distance parallel to the XY gantry. For that, I'm sliding the piece of paper from earlier between the nozzle and the bed, and then I'm using the screws underneath the bed to adjust the distance. You know it's the right distance when you can move the piece of paper with a little bit of friction between the nozzle and the bed. That's a very unsciencey way, but that's basically how everybody is doing it. And because changing the distance at one corner is going to affect the distance at the three other corners, you're going to repeat that for all four corners until you're satisfied. And that, ladies and gentlemen, has been a breeze with the leveling assistant. You can see here on the touchscreen there are four predefined spots, and when I click one, the nozzle is gonna lift the bed and then go there. I remember having to do this tedious task without any assistant, and I also gotta admit I have mixed feelings about this because there's tech out there to avoid this task completely. But for now, all I gotta say is thank you, Flying Bear, for including this into the firmware. It's great, honestly. So now that we finally have the printer operational, it's time to follow ancient 3D printer traditions and print whatever is on the included SD card. Honestly, till this day, I have no idea what it is. What I know is that the first print was sort of smooth, more about that in a minute, and I almost forgot to put on the cover. And then I remembered that it's actually bad for printing with PLA, so I went to convertible mode while eating blueberries. They were actually surprisingly good for that time of the year. So now let's have a look at the print. And I got a spoiler for you, the result is amazing. You guys know that white filament is not very forgiving, and even here you can only see a few imperfections. I haven't seen such a nice top finish for a long time. And also the layer alignment, just look at it. It's perfect. Keep in mind, this is the stock printer without any tuning or calibration, even though I doubt I'm gonna do any of that anytime soon. So, what exactly was not so smooth, you may ask yourself. So during the print, I heard an occasional knocking sound like this. And I really had no idea where it came from until I looked to the left. The brass fitting there had a very sharp edge and it was shaving the filament. And every time that happened, more or less, the filament gave a knock, and it happened more than you may think. But now that we know the problem, it's easily fixed. More or less. And once all the edges were deburred, I didn't get any shavings anymore. Great. Because I have no idea what to do with that mystery print, it's time to slice my own stuff. And for that, I'm downloading Ultimaker Cura. That's the slicer recommended by the manufacturer. And what's pretty neat is actually that Flying Bear has an entry here in the list of presets. And that buggy scroll bar makes me remember why I hate Cura from the bottom of my heart. You can see here, it's jumping around. Just use Super Slicer. Yeah, Ghost 5 here. Yeah, it's the previous generation, but I think it's almost similar in specs. So yeah, I'm choosing that as a preset. The only change I made is that I added a little script. I didn't show it earlier, but the bed basically stays where it is at the end of the print, and it's hard to access the print after that. So I had to manually lower the bed. So what I did is I added a little bit of NG code, and it's gonna do the work for me. And see here, the tooltip is permanently visible. Yeah, Cura is just broken. I'm sorry, I'm getting distracted here. What I meant to say is that the print bed is getting lowered to the very bottom for easier access to the print at the end of the print. Yay. So now it's time to wrap up the setup and print one of those infamous Benchys. That's the little boat here. The Benchy came out really, really nice. I mean, it's not the most beautiful one. You can see here we got a little issue with stringing, which we could tweak if it would bother me that much. But honestly, I'm just so blown away by the overhang here at the hull, because my Prusa Minis, they suck at part cooling. Overhangs like these, they just don't come out right. And here it's just the way it's meant to be. Overall, it's a very, very good Benchy. And again, it's out of the box without any tweaking or adjustments. Same about the calibration cube. Please just ignore the green spot where I managed to spill some super glue and glue that thing to my work surface. So the layer alignment is not as good as before, but just look at those sharp edges. No ringing, which could mean we're going too slow. So maybe we're going to ramp up the speeds later on. But let's check the dimensions. We're about 1% off in all directions, which is totally fine for me. I think we all got a little bit numb with the strive for perfection. Those 0.2 millimeters are well within ISO 2768-1 tolerances. And also, honestly, I think my 12 euro caliper is not allowed to complain about 1% offset. But of course, if anyone from MiTutorial is watching this, just drop me an email, then we can settle this once and for all. As luck would have it, I had a huge printing order incoming, like almost 400 hours of printing. So that was a great opportunity to put the new printer through its paces. I haven't finished editing that video yet, so be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell in case you don't want to miss it out. I swapped out the nozzle to a 0.8 millimeter nozzle, otherwise it would have taken twice as long, and then I gave it a go. The printer just plowed through like 5 kilograms of filament within a week. And then, unfortunately, we ran into some problems. The nozzle was clogged and it was extruding, well, red stuff, which is no bueno. I have an idea where it's coming from, so let's take this thing apart and see what's going on. Unfortunately, I messed up the recording a little bit, so just take my words for granted here. You can see 4 screws, 1 screw at each corner, then 2 screws for the extruder, and then there are 2 more screws in the middle, that's the section where I messed up, to remove the whole hot end assembly. And again, hats off to Flying Bear for going the extra mile to make this thing removable. So it's all just screws and plugs, makes maintenance and repair so much easier. And by now, you should have already spotted the culprit, so let's take out the hot end and have a closer look. So this red PTFE tube is supposed to guide the filament through the cold end. And for some reason it got molten and pushed through the nozzle. And that's not supposed to happen, obviously. In its defense, I was printing at about 245 degrees Celsius to support the high flow rate PTG 0.8 millimeter nozzle, you know it. And of course it was basically printing 24/7. However, the Prusa Minis were just doing fine. So unfortunately they had to finish the job, and that makes me think that, I don't know, it's either the heat break of the Ghost 6 or the cold end cooling. One of those things need to be improved for future generations. I mean, with PLA you're probably gonna be good, but the printer comes with an enclosure and that makes you want to print with ABS because that's what enclosures do. And then, you know, you may run into some problems there. I changed back to a 0.4 millimeter nozzle and then I re-leveled the bed and started a new print. I may look a little skeptical here, I could watch printers for hours basically, but the print is just doing fine and the result speaks for itself. This is Filamentum's Wizard's Voodoo PLA, and those are templates for a watch strap, so if you want to see me failing with leather, you know what to do. So let's answer the age-old question, is it any good? Hell yeah, it is! If you're on the lookout for a Core XY 3D printer which delivers impeccable quality straight out of the box, man, this price is hard to beat. I mean, of course, it's not perfect. You've seen the heat creep issue, and also I wish it really had mesh bed leveling because I hate manual bed leveling. And there are a few nitpicky things which I'm just going to display here, and you can pause the video to see, to read them. But at the end of the day, I think you're going to get a lot of printer for your money here. And I'm very grateful that Flying Bear reached out to me for this collaboration. If you're interested in buying one, be sure to check out the description. There's a discount code. I'm not getting anything out of it, but you know, you will get a small discount.
Yeah, my dog just came to visit. Yeah. Say hello.
So, at the end of the day, you have to decide
whether you want to buy this printer or not. And I hope that I could help you with that decision. And I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something new, maybe, maybe not. And I'm sorry, Flying Bear, but yeah, there's still room for improvement, and I hope to see them in the Ghost 7. So, bye-bye.